this may look like an apocalyptic backdrop to some scary movie, but this is actually real-time street art happening in Liberia. This artist right here, Stephen Doe, is working to save the lives of his fellow Liberians in downtown Monrovia. There we go. I like that. So Stephen has painted no kissing, avoid hugging, avoid handshakes, do not touch the dead or dying. This is a pretty dire state of an emergency, and it's a real state of emergency that was actually just lifted 2 days ago. Things are settling down. There is hope for this community fighting Ebola, and their collective pulse right now is very serious. It's something hopefully none of us will ever have to face. But when I saw this street artist, I made that instant connection with him, and I wish him hope and peace and tranquility for his next mural. In 45 days, a trial vaccine is being delivered to downtown Liberia, and hopefully it'll get there in time to give Stephen the chance to create something beautiful and something new. These are murals in downtown Los Angeles. Maybe he'll have a chance to let children get back to their lives and restore a sense of normalcy, like these beautiful paintings in Oslo and Philadelphia. And imagination can outrank fear once again, like these colorful walls in Kiev and Brooklyn. And protective gear will be for space travelers only. And kissing will be the new epidemic, like this cool, uplifting mural in Richmond. The responsibility and privilege of a street artist is to find the city's collective pulse, whether past, present, or future, and fuse it with his or her own style. Working with a public building like this on a public wall is, you have a lot of people behind the scenes. You've got building owners, property owners, city officials, and funding organizations. My name's Mirinda Reynolds, and I am a street artist, a mom, a muralist, an art teacher. I paint on a lot of different things, canvas, my classroom board. I show at a gallery, and one of my more unconventional places of painting is on the pavement. I help organize a street painting festival yearly, and next weekend I'm traveling to Houston to street paint for a very big festival. I'm very excited about it, and you may be asking yourself, why bother to paint on pavement if it's just going to get washed away? Well, the reason why is because it's part of interacting with a community. It's sharing. And just like you go to a movie for 90 minutes, you don't take all those movie stars home with you and keep them forever. You leave them in the theater. If you go to hear a live musical performance, you enjoy the music and you let them go home to their lives. Well, the same with us. When we perform on the street, we're giving you a piece of what we do, and years of hard work and training have led to us being able to share that and interact with a community. And this leads to greater things. People will want to come into the gallery and buy a print or an original. It's just a great way to make that connection. Plus, it's fun and messy. This is where my journey began. This was the very first piece of street art that moved me as an artist. And I even drove 700 miles during college while a senior at VCU to experience it in person. This image is not a tunnel, it's actually the side of a bank wall in downtown Columbia, South Carolina. And when I first saw it in a book, I said, that can't be that convincing in person. So I went and I experienced it and I stood in front of it. I was about this high right here, shorter than the sign, and I was mesmerized by the transformation. It was almost like a spiritual experience. I was in awe of what this artist had accomplished, and I didn't dream at that moment that I could ever accomplish anything great. I just appreciated it and thought, wow, I need to find some more of these walls and find out how these artists conceptualize it. The artist said it came to him in a dream, but it awakened something in me. All right, a year later, I accepted a position right here in Stafford County at Grafton Village, and I relocated. When I drove across the Chatham Bridge for the very first time, this was my first impression of the city, of a forgotten and unfinished place. I thought, gosh, I hope there's more. And there was. Around the corner, inviting restaurants, beautiful displays downtown, charm, everything that I craved about a city that wasn't just a box. And I've called it home ever since. It's been 20 years now, almost 20. And when you look at this wall, you see that there's a potential. It's tall, it greets you the minute you cross the bridge, but it really needs something. Well, I thought about it. I thought about it a lot, maybe a few thousand times. Every time I crossed the bridge for a decade, I looked at the wall and thought, oh, some artist really needs to get hold of that wall. Well, I let everyday life get in the way. The good things in life, starting a family, buying a beautiful home, living downtown, and teaching full time, which was an incredible experience. After 12 years, I got the courage to go to the bike store owner. And I'd been going to the bike shop quite a bit. As you see here with my family, we bought all of our bikes, from the littlest starfish to the big bikes that they ride now. And I approached the owner and said, hey, I'd like to do a mural on your wall. I know it sounds crazy. I'm not the best artist in the world. I'm not the most famous artist, but I have a passion for your wall. And I'm sure he thought I was a little off. But he was accepting. He got me. He understands artists. He came to all of our gallery openings, and he'd seen my work, and he said, sure, you know, find the funding. Well, that was another adventure. About 5 years later, you know, I kept my ears open and eyes open for, you know, $6,500 to fall out of the sky. And I was invited to the City Arts Commission to pitch my idea for possible funding. That happened in 2012, just a couple months before the mural. Well, I decided on a three-part plan of action. If I have three strong plans going into this meeting, I'm possibly going to get some funding. So what do I have to lose? I went in, and just like this Route 66 mural, it's an invitation of greater things to come. I needed to invite people on a 40-foot wall to want to experience more around the corner. Festivals, shopping, arts, dining, so much more than a faded wall. Well, you may not notice it at first, but there's four stars in each corner. There's a silhouette and an outline of the city behind it, and this very bold graphic of the street sign. So the artist is using a bunch of symbols really fast to communicate, hey, you're gonna have a four-star experience if you just drive down this road on Route 66. You can just hear them saying it. And that's exactly what a good mural does if a street artist pays attention to that collective pulse. Okay, the second part of my plan was to wow them with color. Every sketch that I presented was full of inviting, enticing colors that shared the beautiful color and rhythm of our city. And I think the most beautiful time of a city has just happened. All of the leaves changing as you cross the bridge is a very inviting time to experience Fredericksburg. So as you see, I mixed in a lot of fall colors. These are the actual paints that I use for the project. The last and most important part that I pitched for funding was to involve the community. I asked area art teachers and educators to nominate students who have an interest in the arts and might want to pursue the arts as a career, if they'd like to be an apprentice and have a whole week internship one-on-one with three professional artists. And I had a really incredible team of exciting young people, ages 14 to 17, from all over the area, not just Stafford, but King George, Spotsylvania. And as you see here, we really put them to work. They each wore their own harness and got up and got really messy with us. Now, the one thing I really wanted to avoid was visual overload. When too many people's ideas come together, and there were quite a few, the meeting went very well, and everybody at the meeting, all 12 or 13 of them, each had an idea to share about what should go on the wall. Well, as you see at the State College mural, it would take a full afternoon and a lengthy brochure just to understand everything happening, like a Beatles album cover. Well, we narrowed it down to two main concepts. The city, who wanted to provide funding, was very interested in a colonial mural, something about our wonderful, spectacular history and the fact that we were founded in 1728. Well, the owner of the building wanted to promote his bicycle shop, and bikes weren't invented until the late 1800s, right at the turn of the century, as seen here on the White House lawn. How would I merge these two ideas together that were so seemingly different? I didn't want to do anything silly. And here's our own beloved George Washington, who grew up just a few hundred yards from the mural site, and he's never experienced training wheels. Why not look back in time? Well, with funding on the line and with a possibility of us not coming to a conclusion of a final image, I really had to visit the place that made me the happiest, and that is Chatham Manor. I've been taking my family there since they were born. It's a beautiful historic plantation full of Civil War history, and it's right across the bridge overlooking the city. It's a favorite vantage point, and they recently cleared a bunch of these trees, so you can see it even better now. With a modern cyclist and a bike I bought from the bike shop, I presented this image, and it was unanimously approved. So great, now I have 10 days to get everybody together, all my equipment and paints and everything, and make it happen, no problem. I'm not joking about the 10 days. So for those 10 days, I hired professional painters who knew how to prepare the surface for longevity. They scraped truckfuls of ivy off, they patched and repaired areas, power washed, and in 6 days, we had a beautiful new surface. And many people just complimented us on the blue wall. They were happy with that. Here's our lift. On August 1st, this lift was delivered, and I bonded quite a bit with it. Here's our view from above, below, and behind us, overlooking the Chatham Bridge. And what can I say about it? It took us a full week to master. And the kids were really nervous on it at first. Their knees shook quite a bit, and it didn't help that it was 100 degrees for several of the days. But it really made it a safer way to teach students. It was basically a cage, remote controlled, and it enabled us to move about the wall freely and reach areas that we needed. A lot quicker and safer than a ladder or scaffolding. All right, so each student started on a Monday, finished up on a Friday. We were able to work with 5 students, and we taught them a simple graphing process. If you look, you see blue painter's tape marking off letters at the top and numbers on the side, and each blue tape mark going down marked a 16-inch spot. We worked in a row at a time, and instead of drawing the whole thing out and spilling the beans and letting everybody know what we were making, we decided to have a little fun with it, trust our graphing process, and start from the top. So our very first student up did the top border with us and some of the leaves. The next student worked on the sky with us. The next student, the horizon line. Well, my lead assistant and I became quite comfortable on the lift. We had become Rosie the Riveter. And we were basically floating above the city in a metal cage because we wanted to. And we had great local community participation. Every single day, the Freelance Star showed up and created an award-winning documentary of our project from day one. Washington Post even stopped by and surprised me one day and included us in their Second Glance series. So we really felt like we were being watched constantly, which was a good thing. It's good to be watched when you want to be watched. Okay, we actually finished on time. We got an entire mural done in 30 days. Even though severe storms moved in for 2 days, we were able to speed up and account for that. And we were just absolutely thrilled that we were able to accomplish all of this in our given time and stay within our budget, which is a very difficult thing to do with an outdoor project. Now, as I wrapped up, I wanted to record every little detail, every texture of the wall, every curve, every metallic reflection. And as I looked back on the project and thought about the culmination of our efforts as a team, I remembered the things that matter to us most. And with the eyes of a new mother, trying to remember every little detail, trying to make every slide work, here we go. I was reminded of a beautiful quote from Buddha that said, in the end, these things matter the most. How well did you live? How fully did you love? And how deeply did you let go? It was hard to let go because it was a really great month. So here's a little before and after for you. 17 years of thinking about it and dreaming about it, having Walter Mitty-like fantasies about it, of scaling the wall, and 30 days of painting it with a great team. On September 7th, the new mayor, Mary Catherine Greenlaw, and the city council congratulated our students who worked so hard, and we were able to provide them a stipend for their work. It was a great celebration. They even brought a cake that had a picture of the mural on it. It's a very great way to celebrate the end. The mural's still there. And today, I do have my eyes on new walls. I've even set up a GoFundMe site for the Water Tower Mural Project. And the city doesn't know about this yet, so I'm really excited to explore the possibilities of the new walls around, and I hope that you will with me too. I have a little present for you guys. Under your seats, taped to your chairs, is an invitation for you to go visit the wall and explore the walls around you and share it with others. Thank you very much.